So many people think that they lost pretty much critical time and critical days where they could have found either the airplane, survivors, or even debris from this flight.
Murders, mysteries, unexplained stories, and our family's crazy opinions on them all. Join us now. The Family School of Thought is in session.
How's everybody doing today?
Good.
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 Good. Well, Cass, is it still 100 degrees in Portland?
It is not. It is about 70 degrees. It's a little bit muggy, which is, it's weird for Portland to be muggy. A lot of people were complaining about it this week because it kind of, it got really cloudy. We had some fire scares, which basically put a bunch of smoke in the air.
Right.
So it's been really cloudy and muggy, but it is not 100 degrees, which is great. We had one one lightning strike. That was it. Just a single lightning strike.
One single one.
One single one because it was so muggy.
Oh. Well, it's been like kind of nice. It's definitely like a fall weather in Michigan. Wouldn't you guys say?
Yeah, it's been
It's cold at night. It gets into like the 50s, 60s, but then it's like 70 degrees during the day.
Cold in the mornings.
I mean, I've been all week in my favorite place here, and it was it never was a really hot day, except for. Of course, we had Weasel Fest on Saturday, and that was
hot. Yeah. That was a hot.
That was the only hot day we had.
But it wasn't like overly hot temperature wise. It just the sun was hot.
It about three.
But we had a nice breeze.
Burning high.
We had a nice breeze setting up on that patio.
Yeah.
No, we didn't.
Yeah.
Okay. But anyways, there was not enough shade on that patio.
No, I agree. Not enough shade.
You guys wouldn't have talked to me into cutting down that big tree, it would have been nice and shady.
I did not convince you to do that, but yes, you are right.
Yeah. Okay. And Cass had a birthday, and it went well.
Mm-hmm.
Did some rock climbing on your birthday.
I did. I did some rock climbing, went to work.
Oh, fine.
Just another day.
Okay, let's get going.
Okay.
Yeah.
Jess, we need some for the day.
So I have a few, especially since I missed our last podcast.
We missed that last one.
I'm sorry about that. Phone went dead, forgot about it, went to bed, and didn't think about it until the next morning. So, I apologize. So, I have a few. A couple of them we've already talked about, so I thought that they were worth mentioning. The chainsaw was invented, that originally invented because of childbirth, to assist with childbirth. So, we've already mentioned that one. We brought that one up before. So, I thought, it's there. It's in the amazing facts. Mental floss, amazing facts.
Must be real.
It's real. It's a real fact right there.
I'm glad I didn't have to have one.
Yeah. Other one is we talked about briefly the woman of color of NASA that basically like created everything that we know of NASA, but was behind the scenes. Mathematician, her name is Katherine Johnson. She was immortalized in the Oscar-nominated film Hidden Figures. She wrote the book on rocket science, the literal book. She wrote the book on, she co-authored one of the first textbooks on space while working in the NASA's Flight Dynamics branch and their Langley Research Center. So she literally wrote the book on rocket science, Katherine Johnson.
I knew that. I knew that one.
Well, I remember, you know, like we talked about it, but I couldn't
remember. Yeah.
And so I
remember
Katherine Johnson. So.
And she had a lot of extra time because she couldn't use the restroom where she worked.
Right. Exactly. She had to go down
across
the street. Yeah. So, and since we talked about Cassie's birthday, and it's September, the most common birthday is September 9th.
Yes, I heard that.
Oh, you were so close. It's
kind of odd. We have so many September birthdays, but none on the 9th.
Right.
None on the 9th. But yeah, I didn't know it was like that specific with 9th, but I did know September was really popular for birth months because, you know, Christmas. 9 months before that is Christmas and everyone's feeling festive.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Our New Year's.
I had noticed.
Yeah.
New Year's Eve. New Year's Eve.
No, it's Christmas. It's
Christmas. The week. Yeah, it's like that. Christmas. It's, you know, December, January.
Yeah, you're right. It's like the month of December and probably like with New Year's too. Yeah.
Yes.
So, but I just thought I'd share that one. So
probably when you think about it, like if it was New Year's, well, everybody's kind of prepared and New Year's, you're going to have a good time.
Yeah.
Christmas, everybody's busy trying to get everything caught up and, you know, so they're not prepared.
They're in the moment.
Just guessing.
Just guessing.
But I did notice this, if you ever think about it, whenever you're talking to somebody, you know, about birthdays, and because we have so many in September, you start writing them all off. And certain families have months that are always big for them.
Yes.
Like some families, it might be April. Like everybody in our family's born in April, or everybody in our family. So that's kind of weird.
Yep. Ours is September.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
So, definitely. My next one, this is a short one too. Triscuit crackers. We all know and love
Triscuit them. Crackers,
right? Yeah. They were named for the fact that they were baked by electricity. And that's where you get Trisk.
Wow. That's cool.
That's actually really interesting.
So there you go. They must have been, it doesn't say they were the first. But I'm assuming, given the name, they were probably the first cracker that was baked with electricity.
Oh,
that's cool.
And I have one more fact. I told you I had a bunch. We're going to play catch up. They were all too much that we had to use. In 2000, a romance novel titled Zabiba, and I may be pronouncing that right, Zabiba and the King, it was about a mighty ruler who falls for a spirited commoner. It was published in Iraq. Can you guess who the author was?
Are they from Iraq?
Yes. I can tell you they're no longer alive.
No way.
I was gonna say, did they maybe plan an attack on America?
Yes. Saddam Hussein
wrote a romance novel.
Yep. Yes.
That's kind of
And I think it's called Zabiba and the King. It's Z-A-B-I-B.
And maybe we should read it and maybe we'll know how all his attacks are on
your job is to read that.
He's dead, Mom.
And give us a report on it.
I know, but like maybe it has all of the hints how he supposedly attacked the United States.
We know. Oh, you don't know how he attacked the United States?
Well, I know, but maybe he has more attacks in his book.
I don't think so.
Okay.
But again, he's dead and like they're not.
Well, he's still got a lot of followers.
And, okay. Well, this is like trivia stuff. So I'm pretty sure our government has probably read this book. I kind of want to read it, but I also don't really want to order it because then it's like a red flag. Oh, they're ordering
a book. Interesting that you want that book.
I need you to find a way to get that book and read it and tell us what.
I'm sure you can get it on Amazon.
Imagine him writing a romance novel.
I'll have to go to the book. I'll have to make a special trip to the book.
And what did he think romance meant?
When we are over at the launch on Sunday, we're going to have to sneak and go to the bookstore there.
Yeah. We'll sneak into a bookstore and read it behind the shelves.
You know, we have like banned books in America, but I'm pretty sure this one's probably not banned.
That's your most that interesting.
That will be my homework. Okay. That'll be my homework.
Yes.
Okay.
Definitely.
And I lied. I have one more piece of trivia.
Okay.
I have one more piece of trivia. This one I think everybody knows. The song Jolene.
Jolene.
We all know. We all love. It's her hit song. The character Jolene is actually based off of a real person. It was a bank teller who would flirt with Dolly Parton's husband.
Yes, I knew that.
I did know that one. Yeah.
For our listeners, there's a little piece of trivia, but I debated on saying it because I figured we all knew that.
You were just trying to...
There's something with the beat, too. The like...
Phil and Matt, because of Dolly Parton.
I can't think of it.
I know. I'll tell you another trivia. A bit of trivia. I secretly regret not naming Cass Jolene.
I mean, it would have gone with the theme. I was very off theme.
Every time I hear that song, I'm like, why did we not name one of our kids Jolene?
And
I love that name. I love that song. Yeah. I mean, not that it would be a good song to use as your anthem.
I wouldn't have cared.
But still,
but I like Cass.
I had auburn hair for a while.
Yeah.
You look like Cass. They would have
bought with your J theme, too.
I know.
Jordan, Jesse, Cassie, and Danielle.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Kind of going alphabetical, but not really.
And I told that to many people. Like, I don't know why we never named one of our girls Jolene. It's like, it would have fit everywhere, you know. But anyway. Mm-hmm. Well.
Okay, so enough with the name game.
Yeah.
Fun Let's facts. Hear a song game.
Go.
She knows. She knows.
This one's all over TikTok.
What is it?
So this is actually a very popular song on TikTok right now. It is J. Cole's She Knows. But so this song samples another song, which is by a band named Colts, and it is the song Bad Things, which samples some of Jim Jones's recordings.
Oh,
so cool. When he was giving his speeches, this band basically took parts of those speeches and people's reactions at those speeches and put it in their song Bad Things, and then J. Cole then took that song and put it in his song. So it's kind of the weirdest thing is that they keep kind of using this song about Jim Jones.
Wow. That is
really weird.
That's weird.
Yeah.
But it is a pretty popular song on
It's a very popular song on TikTok.
What?
And
what?
I actually found this information on TikTok. So I even have to thank TikTok for the creepy
What
fact.
Is the appeal of the song?
It's like...
It's supposed to be like when someone's being very suspicious, you know.
Yeah.
And you know.
Yeah. It's like, you know, like if somebody is like having an affair, it's like they're like, she knows.
Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be like, yeah, the person already knows about it.
Or you like,
and they use
you
it a lot.
Know that you screwed up, but you're trying to act like you didn't.
Alrighty then.
That's the song for the day.
Awesome.
Yay.
Okay. Well, if you guys are ready, Cass, I think you're up.
I think I am. It is my yes, it is my week this week. And I decided to do more of kind of a disaster, kind of a mystery. But so this is the disappearance of Malaysian Flight 370.
Ooh, yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. We remember that.
Yes. So just happened recently. It happened in March 8th of 2014. 9 passengers, including 12 crew members and 227 flyers, left the Kuala Lumpur International Airport. For the first 38 minutes of this flight, everything was normal. Everything was fine. The Boeing 777 was in contact with air traffic control. And they were flying to Beijing, China, at I think it was at night. The times are really weird. All the articles I could find were like weird time, like each was different because they were in different time zones. So I'm guessing it was later evening or the night. After the 38 minutes of flight, the plane was passing from Malaysian airspace into Vietnamese airspace over the South China Sea, and they signed off from the air traffic control as expected, and was given a good night and good well wishes. And that was the last time anyone spoke to Malaysian Air Flight 370. And now, 8 years later, there has only been small pieces of debris found of this flight across the Indian Ocean. So we still to this day really don't know what happened to this flight. Everything is basically not coincidence, but conspiracy theories and possibilities, but we don't know for sure what happened. So we have a semi-flight path of where the plane went, but even that has come into question. What we were given as a flight path basically shows that immediately after they flew into Vietnamese airspace, right after their final goodbye to Malaysian airspace traffic control, the flight did pretty much a 180 and went back the exact same direction it had just come from, and flew back over Malaysia. And it is said that they actually followed a path that basically bisected the country of Malaysia and the Thailand border, which would have made it so that they were in neither country's airspace and they wouldn't have to have talked to air traffic control if they followed this flight path. And instead of going over the South China Sea, the flight actually went back across Malaysia and into the Indian Ocean, which wasn't in like it when the flight finally basically was called missing, they believed that it had been hijacked, and the search was actually in the South China Sea for the first 4 days before the flight path was released to the public, which showed that the flight wouldn't have even been in the South China Sea. It would have been in the Indian Ocean, which is a completely different space. So many people think that they lost pretty much critical time and critical days where they could have found either the airplane survivors or even debris from this flight if they had been searching the right area. But it basically flew back over Malaysia into the Indian Ocean and disappeared. We have yet to really find any instances or signifiers of where this plane went. It just disappeared. Even a crash site, there's never been found a crash site or possibilities of where it could have been.
And so somebody kidnapped or hijacked the plane, took it off course where they knew they wouldn't be able to be traced, and then probably the passengers themselves probably crashed the plane or overtook the hijack.
That's the thing, is that they don't believe, so they believe that none of the instances, so nothing is for sure. And one of the things was that it could have been hijacked, but that was a theory that was pretty much tossed away really quickly because no terrorist groups really ever claim this flight missing, which is odd.
My next question is, who would have benefited from them?
Right. So nobody has ever claimed this. And it's odd for even like a politically motivated attack. It's odd for somebody not to claim it. So they don't believe it was hijacked, or it's a really small possibility that it was hijacked. And they don't believe anybody on the plane was conscious during the flight. Basically, they believe that the plane was depressurized, which basically made everybody on the plane, other than whoever took control of this flight, was passed out unconscious. So nobody was aware of what was happening. And that's why they, because there was no real indicator of panic. There was no distress calls. There was no seemingly, you know, if a plane had gotten hijacked when everybody on the plane was conscious, you would have thought they would have called loved ones. Like even on the 9/11 terrorist attacks, they called their loved ones and said the plane is being hijacked. So most people theorize that nobody, passengers or even crew members, were conscious during the flight.
Well, how could they be unconscious? I mean, so, do you think they're fast or?
So basically, when you had
a mask on.
So there was I don't want to say anything is truth or it's a, you know, thing. It's everything about this is rumors. There's rumors that some people who got on the plane, Russian passengers, had scuba gear and they were looked at of maybe they brought the scuba gear on and depressurized the plane and used that oxygen from the scuba gear to stay conscious. But mom, basically depressurizing a plane is when you fly on a plane, you're going up so high in the air that you're basically at a different altitude and different oxygen level. So they have to pressurize the plane so that you don't lose conscious. And when you depressurize it, you're basically taking out oxygen from the air.
Mm-hmm.
So they would have almost like immediately fallen unconscious. And it happens. Oh, sorry, Jess.
I was going to say, it's kind of similar to like when scuba divers come, if they come up too quickly, I forget there's a term for it, but when they come up too fast, it's like basically they end up having a stroke and they die.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. Like they could, kinks? You know, but
like, what? Is it called kinks or something like that?
Something like that. It's like, I think it starts with an S. Like,
the bend, I want to say the bends or something.
The bends. Yes, you're right.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it's when you, either you're not getting enough oxygen or you're getting too much oxygen too fast and you're basically, overloading your brain.
But still, whoever, the hijackers of the plane died, went down with the plane too. I mean, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's unsure. It's unsure because even like the black box, they didn't recover the black box, but they have basically a radar of possible flight path, or they say this is the flight path, that basically went back over Malaysia, kind of went up the straits that are right there. I think I have a map that'll be easier to like understand. So this is like, if you can see, hold on, sorry, I forgot to share my screen. The flight path is kind of very weird, and it goes in a weird direction. So the red is where it starts and where it kind of is supposed to go. And then you see with the blue, it turning around back over Malaysia and Thailand. And then another theory that came around was that right where you see the like bottom of the V at the blue line, they kind of go back up the Straits of Malacca, and it is the hometown of the captain of the flight, and there has been rumored witnesses that saw the plane basically dip its wing towards the town for a long period of time. And because of these like rumored witnesses saying they saw the plane, the plane wasn't kind of going towards this town. It was basically the wings, it like almost went sideways for a long period of time, but continued to fly straight. And so this was theorized to be the captain basically saying goodbye to his hometown, which led to people believing that this was actually a suicide mission from the captain. And his name is Captain Zahari Ahmad Sa. And unfortunately, it is the most possible theory, because he...
That would make sense, though, with no distress calls, no notification to the passengers.
But did he have anything going in his life that would cause him to do something like that?
I think we lost Cassie.
Oh, good. She left us the map.
Now we can find her.
I guess.
We can't hear her. I'm wondering, though, have you guys ever heard of the show Manifest? Manifest?
Yes.
That's what I think. Yeah.
This. Where they came back like 10 years later or something like that.
Like that's where like maybe this plane actually went into another multiverse. It time traveled or whatever. And then like 10 years from now, we'll find it.
Oh. It shows up again. Yeah. Wouldn't that be something?
Yeah. Kind of. Yeah, I mean, that would be kind of cool. That would, I mean, not cool, but like maybe that's what it would end up being is that...
Well, maybe even the pilot knew what he was doing and flew into a different time.
Yeah, like sorry, went into a
I didn't realize that I...
We solved. Listen, we solved it while you were gone.
Okay, well, so let me... I think you guys are on the same thought that I am. I don't know where I cut out at, but the you captain was... The
pilot was like making it a suicide mission, and that's the most theorized thing.
So, yes, and it's the most theorized because his wife had recently left him with their children, and he had no... It was rumored that he had no appointments or planned events after this date. Even like doctor's appointments, anything like that. And they found that he had practiced this flight in simulations before, many times possibly. And it was the exact flight of going up towards Vietnam, turning around and going back over Malaysia, back over his hometown, and then out into the Indian Ocean. So that is why it's theorized he was.
He had practiced that many times.
So you have to, as a pilot, you have to have certain amount of hours each year that you are a pilot to keep your wings. And so you have to do practice flights on simulations. And they said that he had practiced this flight multiple times.
Or and that he could have known there was a porthole there. Kept trying to
get to it.
Yeah.
It's possible. It's very possible.
What year did this happen?
So this happened in 2014. And then the...
Two more years.
That plan's gonna land in 2 more years.
Yep.
Why?
It's gonna be like the show Manifest. The plane's gonna come. It's gonna be like, I don't know. I've never really seen the show. I think it was like a 5-year period or whatever, but like 10 years after this plane went missing, it's going to end up landing at its destination and they're not going to have aged at all the passengers. And it's going to be the same thing. They have no idea what happened or they went to a different universe.
So it is possible, but there is very little debris found from this flight, but there is debris found from this flight. The flight flap, like the wing flap, has been found off the coast of it was found on the island of Reunion, which is off the coast of Madagascar in the Indian Ocean. I know. This
the one hole was closing and it caught that, and that was like when it closed, it clipped it.
Possibly.
That means the plane crashed on after it went through the porthole. So.
Maybe it crashed on Reunion. All the debris has been found, or the debris was found like in 2016, 2017, so 2-3 years after the crash.
So it could be not related.
And this they know for a fact that it was from 370. Uh-huh. They know it was from the 370 plane. So the plane, they don't know where it crashed, but they do believe it crashed.
It is kind of, I mean, this is not the only flight that has gone missing. I think this was like the most well-known one because there's so many passengers and it was like super odd, but like Amelia Earhart was also a pilot. I mean, she was solo, so it's a little different, but I mean, we don't know where she crashed.
Wasn't solo. Was she solo? I think she crashed with, or she went missing with someone.
Yes, she did. Yeah, there was a guy.
With somebody.
I guess I was thinking she was solo. But, I mean, there's still rumors now that she, like, just crashed in, you know, like, whatever, the Bahamas or whatever, and lived her life there. But, you know, there's
yeah, that's actually the one I was going to do before I picked this flight.
But the Bahamas are on the other side.
I get it. But
it's not the same.
The whole thing with her is the Bermuda Triangle.
Triangle.
What was the guy's name that went on the plane with her? Because wouldn't it be something if they checked the manifest and they found that guy's name on that plane?
Yeah, that would be really weird.
He was basically I think it's considered a solo flight because he basically was just there to document it, as far as I know.
Right. Right.
Like he wasn't flying the plane at all.
Right.
Yeah, he wasn't flying the plane at all. So it probably was a solo flight. It just she needed someone there to document flight pattern. But so another weird thing about this is that because there's so little debris, they believe that it either crashed completely vertical into the water, so it basically went straight down into the water, or it basically gently landed on the water. And because with so little debris, it means that it didn't break up as it crashed into the water or crashed into anything. And it basically either went in vertically or gently landed and slowly sank, which is another reason why people think that the plane was depressurized and basically people died before anything even really happened. Because if they had like gently crashed into the water, emergency landing gear would have went off. People would have had life jackets and probably even tried to survive. Because it's not like the search didn't happen until months. It was like it was in the wrong location for 4 days, but it did continue to happen. And they searched the Indian Ocean after they figured out where it went.
And I mean, it would be kind of neat to find out if they did find it at the bottom of the ocean or anything.
Well, didn't they? Like,
I think they searched the bottom of the ocean, but they couldn't find anything.
Well, how could the plane go down and then them not see anything? So it's got to
be. So there are witnesses. So the thing is, there are witnesses that said that they saw a plane on fire over the Indian Ocean, but they cannot confirm that it was 370. So there are witnesses who they believe saw the 370 crash, or not crash, but basically be in distress above air. But nothing can be confirmed that it was Malaysian Flight 370 that they saw.
Well, and if it was hijacked and they used the oxygen to, like, do you think it could have blown up in the air? I don't know.
Well, there are many people who said that they saw it on fire, which would have mean an explosion happened on flight. So it is possible that they basically depressurized it, flew it over the Indian Ocean, and then set off a bomb. But again, if this had been a hijacking, if this had been a terrorist attack, somebody would have claimed it, because like, why do this without any real indication of why, any indication of what people were supposed to get out of this, like what was the meaning of it? It's very odd for if it was a hijacking.
I don't think it was a hijacking. I never really thought it was, but
makes
sense for the pilot to be on.
It's just so mysterious. I mean, everything just.
So,
I mean, does it say anything about the pilot's home life? Was he?
Yeah, he was having marital problems
during that time.
He was having marital problems. His wife had just left him and taken their children with her. But I mean, that's really, like, other than that, there's really nothing else. And it sucks for this Captain Saw's family, because if he didn't do this, like, it is the most popular theory, which kind of, if he didn't do it, you know, it even if he did, like, it's very sad for his family, who still has to basically have the brunt of this fault on them.
Yeah.
Right.
There are some other, like, kind of conspiracy theories that this plane was basically taken by military governments, whether that be the U.S., China, North Korea, Russia. Just months after this plane disappeared, another Malaysian Flight 17, was actually shot down by what was said to be the Russian military while they were flying over Ukraine airspace. So it basically started another theory of maybe that's what happened to Malaysian Air Flight, was they were shot down over the South China Sea and basically went into distress and couldn't contact anybody.
You would still think, I mean, that kind of makes sense, though, too. But you would think that, especially in 2014, that people would have been calling loved ones knowing that the plane was going down.
Right.
Been radioing in distress.
Yeah.
Well, that's another thing that it makes it weird, is that this has happened, if it was an intentional suicide by the captain, this has happened before, and basically they made it known that that's what was going to happen to air traffic control. They basically said, this is, I'm taking this flight over, we will not be making it to destination, kind of things. So they indicated that this was a suicide mission, which he did not. There was no indication that anything was wrong during the first 38 minutes of this flight.
Wow.
Yeah.
Interesting.
But I mean, there's thousands of theories, because this, like, nothing really other than small, like, it's not even like, oh, it's, you know, the nose of the plane, it's the tail of the plane. It's basically very small pieces of the plane that some even say could have just fallen off during flight. So who knows what happened?
Well, if they got shot down in flight,
mm-hmm.
you know, it could have done enough damage immediately where people just didn't even have time to even do anything.
Well, yeah,
which makes sense. If it was shot down, it was like an immediate thing, but then it flew for far too long. If it was so much damage that it would have been immediate. I think it was basically until they have radar until basically it went out of fuel. So that's going to be a while. That's, you know, it was a scheduled flight. I think it was like 2 hours, maybe, a scheduled 2-hour flight. And they were only in contact for 38 minutes. So that's another hour and a half that this plane basically flew back over where it came from and then flew out into the Indian Ocean.
Okay. And
possibly. So basically the flight pattern we see is basically a V. But they speculate that it actually took another turn and went down south into the Indian Ocean. And that's why the debris was found at Reunion Island.
It was a hijacking.
It's possible. That's the thing. It's possible.
You're right. The plane wouldn't have got shot in the air and then went that long.
It's completely different. Yeah. So it's possible. It's also, so that was the thing, is that some people don't believe that the flight pattern that we see that it took is real. Some people believe that it actually did fly the exact flight path that it took, and that's why they searched there over the South China Sea for the first 4 days. And then basically the pattern we see now was basically hacked into the you know, air traffic control and basically planted this flight path so that people would be like, oh, we got to go look in a different direction and take them off course.
I get that, but then now there's a reason for what they're doing.
Right, exactly.
All that was for nothing.
Right. there was never any indication of why this flight would have been taken. Some people speculate that passengers who were on the plane, there was like 20 passengers who had to deal with aviation and kind of were higher ups in maybe a government, because there was a lot of Chinese citizens on passengers, I should say, on this flight. But again, there was no indication of why they would have been taken, what they needed for these people to do, what the objective of, if it was in a hijacked incident.
That so again, is another one of those things, the more you think about it, the more questions you have.
Right. The more you definitely look it up, the more you try to figure it out, the more it just doesn't make any sense. Even when I was researching it, like the flight pattern, you know, everything is possible. Maybe this is what we believe, kind of thing. Like there is just no, other than the first 38 minutes, there's just nothing that can be proven factual in this story. And even some of the articles I read said that they were in contact, like personal crew members were in contact with air traffic control during those first 38 minutes. And others say that it was automated, an automated system react. Like basically it wasn't, they were talking to an actual person. They were just talking. There's like automated system, like button, like push this and yes, we're on the right course. Basically a signal to air traffic control. So I don't even know if they even really talked to live people those first 38 minutes of the flight. Maybe that first 38 minutes of the flight was already being hijacked.
Jeez.
Yeah, that's crazy. Mm-hmm. This is one of those things, though, that I feel like we'll never have the answers to. We'll never figure it out.
No, unfortunately not. But maybe with all the droughts that are happening and we're seeing a lot of lower water levels, it's possible.
Maybe we want to find the plane exactly where we never expected it.
Right.
Could be. You were right. Maybe it's not even in the Indian Ocean. Maybe it's in the Pacific.
Maybe. I don't know if you guys believe in Megalodon. But maybe Megalodon.
Yeah.
Came up and ate the Megalodon is the gigantic shark, like a prehistoric level size shark that which people believe.
Makes sense when you think about dinosaurs. What are the one thing that would survive in the, you know, like a comet hit?
As a comet. The water creatures.
Yeah, right. It would be the water creatures. So I could see water dinosaurs.
Prehistoric. That's why we can't find.
Loch Ness Monster is probably actually a dinosaur.
Maybe. Probably.
Again, I'm going to get a house psychic to bring on every week so we can get somebody else's thoughts on it.
Yeah, maybe. There was, so I think 2017, maybe. I don't have this written down because none of the articles said anything about it. But there was like a couple years after this happened, some random kid got a voicemail on his phone that was basically in Morse code talking about emergency on 370. And they believed it to be a distress call that just happened to somehow get on his phone. But I don't think that was ever proven to not be just like a hoax. I think they traced the like call back to like California or something like that. So who knows if that was really a hoax, probably. But they did say, the person who got the voicemail said that it sounded like a distress call from, it said 370, and he guessed that it might have been Malaysian Airlines. like 70.
Interesting.
Crazy.
Yeah, it is.
So, next time you get on an airplane, that is supposed to just be a quick flight somewhere.
Now we
could disappear.
That's it, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. I think it'd be more of a concern when you're flying over water.
Maybe.
Because, well, really, though, too, the flight from 9/11 that crashed in, what was it, Pennsylvania or whatever? They really had never found any pieces of that plane either, because it just kind of like disintegrated into the ground.
Yeah, disintegrated. But even that, like, they found an impact area.
Right. Well, that's what I'm thinking. Like, you know, when you hit water, especially from that high up, it's like hitting a concrete wall. Maybe the plane just disintegrated, but because it's water, you know, like you have the, you know, you'd have the initial impact, but it doesn't stay because it's water. It's a liquid form.
It's possible. Mm-hmm.
But it's still, I mean, I would think that you would have the, again, the distress calls, or, you know, calls to
lower. Right.
You know, with the cabin, if it depressurized too soon, or, you know, and so everybody was knocked out and then it just hit the water.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's, I think that is what is basically, I think if there had been distress calls, even like, not even for hijacking, but like, oh, the plane is going down, I think people would, it wouldn't be such of a mystery. I think because there just seems to be no indication of why this flight went down, where it went, what happened to the passengers. That's what, it's why it's such a big story and such a big mystery to the world.
Yeah, I think so too. I mean, it does, it, like, it is weird that, like, not one passenger, one call went out.
Yeah, and even so, once the news, I think shortly, basically because when they lost contact with 370, it was when they were flying into the Vietnamese airspace, which basically meant they had to switch. That's why they, like, it was, they said goodnight to them, was because they were switching into a different airspace. So they would have had to switch over to air traffic control in Vietnam. And immediately they knew something was wrong, because Vietnamese airlines could not, or like air traffic control couldn't get a hold of them. So they knew almost immediately that something was wrong with the flight. And they immediately went on high alert, thought it was a hijacking. And people in Malaysia, or people who had family members on this flight, said that they tried to call their family members and they couldn't get a hold. Like, nobody could get a hold of anybody on this plane, even trying to call them.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's such a weird...
Which, I don't know, like, that, it sounds weird, but also you have to think about, like, everybody puts their phone in or they're supposed to put their phone in airplane mode when they're flying.
Right. Yeah, so I guess that's not so weird. Yeah, you're right. But it's either shut off or in airplane mode.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm...
So it seems odd, but...
I think the plane got hijacked. Because something made... The theory of the air pressure thing sounds right to me. Because obviously everybody in the plane lost consciousness before they really realized what was going on, because somebody would have tried to call, somebody would have made a move somewhere, and that didn't happen, yet the plane still went on for a while. So that so that's what happened there. My only thing I can't figure out is, so they take the plane, kill everybody on there, and crash the plane, but never give any purpose or reason for that. You know, they weren't trying to prove anything.
Right, right. So, yeah, that's a lot of what a lot of people have problems with, the hijacking theory. But again, so because of that that kind of leads into the theory that maybe these passengers were kidnapped, somebody of higher standard or higher ranking, or some kind of person who knew information may have been on this flight that they could, like a governmental agency kidnapped basically everybody on this plane.
I'm sure they went through the manifest and analyzed everybody that was on the plane.
Right. So that's where the, I think it's like aeronautics. There's like, there's 20 members of the Chinese, there. So all together, there's like 152 members, passengers who are of Chinese descent, Chinese citizens. And they said like 20 of them are from some kind of like aeronautic. They were like there as on an exhibition, maybe like aeronautics something. So I think that maybe these people like maybe invented something, and they were showing it off at an exhibition. I don't know. Because nothing can ever really be proved. Like even that, like nobody really knows if that was real or not, which is odd.
Would this the people on the plane, would it have been like more business people or vacationers or
what? So that's the thing, is that this is a very common flight from Malaysia to China. It happens like this flight path happens at least 2 times a day. So it's not like it was a special flight. It's not like it was out of the ordinary. Everything was normal. Everything was, you know. And even like, you got to remember, like this is 2014. This is after 9/11. So they're checking for any kind of weapon. Even the scuba gear. I'm really surprised the scuba gear would have got on this flight if it was a full tank of oxygen. Like, even if they got scuba gear, they would have not been able to, because that's flammable. There's no way they would have been able to get on the plane. Yeah, there's no way
they'd let them on there with that.
Even under, like, not like a carry-on, but like checked in, they would have never allowed that on the plane checked in, because it could have exploded. So, even that theory kind of doesn't really make sense. Mm-hmm. There you go. That's the disappearance of Malaysian Flight 370.
Wow. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that one is a interesting one. I remember it being on the news.
Must have been when they found part of wreckage, because I remember, you know, coming back into the news like maybe a couple of years afterwards or something.
Yeah, when they found the wreckage.
Right.
I mean, it's got to be hard too for the family members of the passengers to like never know.
Right.
What happened to your family member?
Right, and there's been there's been a lot of uproar in Malaysia, basically focused on the government of like, how did you let this happen? Why can't we find this plane? Like, where are our family members? What happened to our family members? You're supposed to know what happened. And you took us on a goose chase for 4 days where we lost critical time of finding this plane.
Right.
It's a lot like the Sewol Ferry disaster, where it was just a lot of bad choices on the government's part.
Right.
And it probably could have had a better ending if people would have just figured shit out prior to.
And it never, there was nothing about this plane that made it special, like something they were trying out or anything like that.
As far as I know, no. There was, but that could also be, it could be the Malaysian government had somebody on this plane that was important, had certain information, and they just didn't want that to get out to the public. So it's possible people are hiding why this plane got hijacked or stolen or anything.
Right.
Who knows?
Yeah, that could make sense too. And it's like a government conspiracy
cover up.
Yeah.
Seems like the government's always in on something's crazy.
Yeah.
Because they're always trying to cover up something crazy.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Unfortunately, governmental officials, anybody in the leadership, hasn't really proven to do what's best for the people, but what's best for them.
Right. Huh. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. That was a good topic.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, like I said, I was actually thinking about doing Amelia Earhart, and I was kind of looking up information on her when I found articles about this flight. And I was like, because it's like Amelia Earhart, it's at a time where you're not really talking to people. You don't have radar. You don't have like statistics. So it's more likely to disappear. Where this one, it's 2014, man. Like, there's so much technology. There's so much things that you can find this plane. Like, how did this plane disappear in 2014?
That's the thing. How could it just disappear and not and nobody find anything about it or where? Anytime there a plane crashes, they get the first thing that they go after is that black box to find out what happened and if they haven't found that.
But that's the thing, is that they have to find the plane to get the black box.
Yeah. Right. And, how could you not find that big of a plane?
Right. And those are supposed, the thing is, black boxes are supposed to survive crashes. They're supposed to be able to float. They're supposed to be able to, be found in water. It's possible they can
find that black box and figure it out. Okay, we need to get a psychic on that because the psychic can find the black box.
Uh-huh. Wow. I don't know. There's got to be something. Especially, so the island of Reunion off the coast of Madagascar is by Africa, which is across the Indian Ocean. So it's not even anywhere near where supposedly crashed. So this debris basically went all the way across the Indian Ocean.
That's why I think that the plane went further than what we know it to have gone. And it probably did crash closer to Africa and, or to somewhere along the coast of Africa or something.
Well, even if it crashed, and I think actually, how could somebody not have seen it or found it yet? I mean, the
that there's so many countries in this world that they still don't have the technology. So maybe it did crash somewhere where people don't have cell phones or computer and internet and all that kind of stuff.
Well, and also, it's not like you can see, it's not like Malaysia and Reunion are really close together. Like, this is a very far distance that these places are apart. So it's possible it crashed in the middle of nowhere. And basically tides just brought it to the island Reunion off the coast of Africa. Like, I think multiple pieces of this plane were found in Reunion, but other places were found, other debris was found in Australia. Somewhere else. Oh, that's so it's crazy. Yeah. So Australia. It's definitely not from Malaysia. So that's the thing, is Australia is not far from Malaysia, but it's basically, so this is why they think it basically went towards Antarctica. Like, it basically flew south because it basically would have crashed in between Australia and Africa, and then basically all the pieces kind of scattered throughout the Indian Ocean.
Right, yeah. Oh. Yeah, and we have to think about perspective of the maps that we know are not accurate of country size, continent size, and ocean size.
Yeah, because I think of the Indian River or the Indian.
It's not a river.
Ocean. I just think of it as a small little Like Lake no. Michigan.
No. No. No.
No, it's bigger, but I mean, on the map, it
it's basically the space, all the water space between Africa, like the European continent, which, like, you know, Thailand, China, and then basically Malaysia, and then Australia, basically that whole water space between those. So if you're like looking at a globe, it's basically that, like, water, like the entire water space between that and Antarctica is the Indian Ocean. So it's like the size of like the Atlantic or the Pacific.
Oh. Wow. Well, the Atlantic.
This is a huge space of water, yeah.
Right. Well, that's very good.
All right. Well, anything else to add to your story, Cass?
That's all I've got. I wish I had more. I wish I had more details, anything. But I don't.
Well, maybe we'll find it. Somebody will watch us and say, hey, that's...
Well, that's another thing is that it could have, like, more debris, bigger pieces of debris could have gone onto, like Jesse said, maybe more not uncivilized, I don't say that, but like
they're places that out of it now. They're like, yeah, the Lord has sent us this big sheet of metal.
right. Or like, you know, places that don't communicate with the outside world.
It was Asian Airlines, is that what it was? What was it?
Malaysian Airlines. It was Malaysian Airlines. So Malaysian Airlines.
Subscribe now that thinks this is God, Malaysian God, that has sent them the materials.
Maybe. Who knows? But there are islands all across the world where it's basically they do not talk to the civilized world. They do not talk to the outside world. Right. They have their own cultures, their own systems. Yeah. So it's possible that bigger parts of this plane landed on those islands.
Wasn't that long ago that they found civilization of
a group? Well, in those islands, they don't welcome outside.
Right, right.
Either. So
they're afraid.
Like, well, no, yeah, there's certain places, I think, maybe even Indian Ocean, where if you go to these islands, they are cannibals, or you will not leave this island. They will murder you.
Yeah.
Because they do not accept people from the outside world. So it's possible.
And that is a possibility because we know not to go to those islands or whatever. And so
right, which explains why we haven't found it. But also, this isn't a small plane that could be hidden in the trees. Like
No. I'm talking about just like parts of the plane. Bigger parts of it. Like, we're not going to go to these islands looking for it.
Right.
Planes must have some type of tracking devices on them.
I think they do, and that's how they have the supposed flight plan, but it basically either... the tracker is taken offline or it dies somewhere in the Indian Ocean. Like, they just lose complete contact with this plane over the Indian Ocean. I think it says the last spot that is seen is like the last, if they call it like the last reported location from radar. So it's the last it's last final sighting on radar. So basically, like, it basically completely disappeared even off radar at that point. So tracking device was offline at that point.
Yeah.
Could be black hole. Could be black hole. Who knows?
It's gonna end up at Skinwalker Ranch.
I
that's what I it is. You know, they're right now digging up this huge metal thing out of the ground, size of a football field. Mm. It's that plane.
An alien spaceship.
Yeah, that's what they're digging up now. Are you watching that?
It all comes back to aliens, though.
It does, always, doesn't it?
Yep. Maybe this whole plane was beamed up into a giant alien spaceship.
Mm-hmm.
And now all the passengers of this plane are the Earth Army on the Battlestar Galactica.
Sure.
That would be kind of neat to have them come back.
Mm. It would be interesting, yeah.
It would be very interesting if the plane did land tomorrow and the people got off the plane and went, how'd you get so old?
Yeah. Well, that's it.
We've only been in an hour and a half. All right. Hey, listen, I think it's time we wrap this up.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Any last thought, or anybody, any last thoughts? Mm. Not about Julie Roberts, about the plane.
Nothing on the plane.
Okay. Well, good topic, Cass. You did a really good job presenting that. And please know that everything we do here is for entertainment purposes only.
Mm-hmm.
And please like, share, and join, subscribe, and give us your feedback. And where can they get us feedback, Cass?
They can comment on our channels. They can follow us on Instagram and maybe DM us there. Yep, YouTube. Tell us if you think you know what happened to the Malaysian Air Flight 370. Maybe other people have clues.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
If there's any psychics out there listening to us, please give us your thoughts.
Yeah. Send us an email at
thefamilyschool@gmail.com.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe you've had some intuitions on that sighting and would like to view your opinions.
Yeah.
Gee, you've never had no dreams about plane crashes?
No. It's mostly just little piddly stuff. I haven't had one in a long, long time.
You're losing your touch.
I'm getting old.
All right, everybody, say goodbye.
All right. Bye, guys.
Bye. I lost internet. What happened?
Okay, I'm closing out. Bye, guys.